I'm here to talk about a perfect crime. It involves a whole host of shady characters. Helpfully, some of them look really shady, so they're easy to spot. But the masterminds of the perfect crime are far less obvious. They wear suits, they attend board meetings, they look a lot like you and me. But these people are the architects of one of the most corrupt and destructive trades on this planet. Their business model is reliant on wrecking the homes of millions of the world's poorest people, on dismantling the planet's life support systems, on robbing countries blind and funneling the money overseas, and convincing us all that this is completely normal and sustainable. I'm talking about industrial logging, the business of cutting down the last tropical rainforests. Google's new tool tells us that this industry is ripping down 50 football pitches worth of forest every minute, every single minute. But what perhaps is most astonishing is that most of us don't really think there's a problem, because we've been tricked, deceived on a quite dizzying scale. And I'm going to tell you how. You can divide the industrial logging industry in the tropics into two categories: the criminal and the legitimate. The criminal is criminal, and the legitimate is much the same, but with better PR. So let's start with the obvious bad guys. In the early 1990s, two friends and I learned that Cambodia's Khmer Rouge guerrillas were funding their war effort by trading timber with Thailand. And Global Witness and the first of our investigations was born. Soon afterwards, posing as timber buyers, we found ourselves up a remote waterway in southern Cambodia, literally up the creek, where we took this photograph. And what we learned was that the Khmer Rouge, one of the nastiest movements in a pretty nasty century, were earning between $10 to $20 million a month from this trade. Fast forward a few years, I found myself in West Africa during the brutal civil wars that decimated Sierra Leone and Liberia. And we were on the trail of another warlord who knew that selling timber was a great way to prop up a murderous regime. That man was Charles Taylor, the former president of Liberia and currently serving a 50-year sentence for war crimes in the UK. And it was in Liberia that we first recognized this huge crossover between the criminal and supposedly legitimate sides of this industry. Two sides of the same coin. Taylor doled out Liberia's forests to a coterie of loyal businessmen, like Dutch timber baron Gus Kuenhoven, here talking about the benefits his company, OTC, would bring to Liberia, and currently facing retrial for trafficking arms into Liberia. And our old friend from the Ukrainian mafia, Leonid Minin, whose photograph I just really like, I'm sorry, a bit gratuitous. These guys proceeded to mine Liberia's forests, and as the timber flowed out, the money and the arms rolled in. And in Europe, two major timber companies, DLH and Danza, bought Liberian timber in the full knowledge that this trade was bankrolling Taylor and de facto a conflict that claimed 250,000 lives. But legitimacy seemed intertwined with impunity. When Taylor's timber trade was finally subjected to UN sanctions in 2003, DLH and Danza walked away from the destruction they helped pay for, their profits intact. Kuenhoven fled to the Republic of Congo, where he's carrying on much where he left off in Liberia. But perhaps none of this is all that surprising. After all, the story of a crazed dictator and his cronies making lives a misery for the citizens of some far-off country is hardly a new one. But what makes this crime so perfect is the less obvious stuff. Because the dictators and warlords over there are facilitated by a cast of supposedly less shady characters over here. And they're brought together by a worldview dreamt up by the logging industry to legitimize its business model. At this point, it's worth reminding ourselves why this matters. Forests are the planet's lungs, and we can't live without them. They're home to 1 in 6 of the world's population. Half of terrestrial plant and animal species live in the forests, and they're crucial to regulating our water, carbon, and climate systems. And ultimately, we can't win the battle to mitigate climate change unless we save the forests. We need to dispel the myths dreamt up by the logging industry to sell their business model. The big myth is that industrial logging in the tropics brings sustainable development, jobs, and money to poor countries. The problem is that it isn't sustainable, and it brings little or no development. But it has spawned a nasty little euphemism, sustainable forest management, which sounds reasonable enough, but in fact is used to guide how this industry is run. Let's look at some examples of this in practice. In Cambodia, the most corrupt country in Southeast Asia, the ruling elite grew spectacularly rich by treating the forest as a personal piggy bank. They sold the forest to their mates to strip out the most valuable timber. And then the World Bank said, we can reform this process, and they packaged it as sustainable forest management in order to drive national development. The international aid community, who funded half of Cambodia's budget, bought into the myth and funneled in millions of taxpayer dollars. The World Bank was wrong. The loggers and their friends in government proved to be unreformable. But to add insult to injury, the government then went on to sell what was left of people's land for rubber plantations. In the last decade, Cambodia has lost its forests faster than any other country in the world except Malaysia. A nation of farmers is being forced off their land. This slide shows a forced eviction. And into the plantations and factories, 400,000 people at the last count. This scenario, where the forests are sold off at the expense of a country's most vulnerable people, while a ruling clique grow unimaginably rich, is an obscenity, but it's far from unique. Last month, I spent 2 weeks in Liberia. When the war ended in 2003, the government, advised and funded by the US government and the World Bank, embarked on a state-of-the-art forestry reform program as a surefire route to creating jobs and money. 11 years on, and Liberia's forest sector is in disarray. A fraction of the projected revenue came in, few of the jobs materialized, local communities were marginalized, and discontent is growing. A very dangerous thing in a country not that long out of a timber-funded war. And the point here is, if you can't get sustainable forest management right, in a small country with a supposedly reformist president and intense international support, where on earth can it work? In 20 years of campaigning, we haven't found any examples, because the economic model behind industrial logging in the tropics is totally flawed. But the industry has done an amazing job at presenting itself as an almost philanthropic venture, bringing jobs and development, rather than being the plunderers that they usually are. So how on earth have we got into this position? That one is easy. Two things bring the criminal and the legitimate sides of the logging industry together: corruption and greed. And in 2012, the tropical logging trade was worth $16 billion. And despite the fact that few economic benefits accrue to the producer country, a few people become very, very rich indeed. This man is the Minister of Forests of Equatorial Guinea, and conveniently, he's also the son of the president. He amassed a multi-million dollar car collection, a $35 million mansion in Malibu, California, a mansion in Paris, and a private jet. And he managed all of this on a salary of $7,000 a month. It would take him between 500 and 700 years to earn enough to buy all of this stuff. So, in order to sell the myth, The logging industry needs people to buy in, and many have. Take Sarawak, Malaysia's largest state on the island of Borneo. Here, a handful of logging companies with close ties to the ruling elite have all but destroyed the state's forests, and they've since gone global. They got going with loans from a major international bank, HSBC, which made £100 million in the process and conveniently forgot about its green forest policy. And the industry needs someone to help them pretend that they care. And this is where some of the more surprising characters come in. Some of the biggest, fluffiest, most famous names in conservation. Take the World Wildlife Fund, for example. They believe that logging is inevitable, and the best way to limit the damage is to work with the industry to improve their practices. We investigated WWF's main vehicle for this. This T-shirt's for real, by the way. And we found a UK timber merchant dealing in illegal timber, a Malaysian logging company clearing orangutan habitat in WWF's own Heart of Borneo project, and a subsidiary of our old friends from Liberia, Danza, linked to human rights abuses. All of this done while they were active members of the WWF scheme. Similarly problematic are the timber certification stamps you look for when you buy your toilet rolls and your furniture. We're told that these mean the timber is harvested legally and sustainably. But the rhetoric is very often different to the reality. Take Taylor again. Some of the companies he was doing business with in Liberia still trade vast amounts of timber today, with the Forest Stewardship Council's stamp all over their publicity. This would be fine if they'd mended their ways, but many haven't. In 2013, we caught one of them importing over $300,000 worth of illegal timber into Europe. So the FSC's logo has, unfortunately, become yet another tool used by the masterminds of the perfect crime to cover their tracks. And a less obvious supporter of the perfect crime is you and me. Our governments, seduced by the idea that rainforests equals cash equals development, pump millions of dollars of taxpayer money into misguided schemes to help improve the tropical logging industry. So we're financing our own destruction. And we don't even know we're doing it. It's a perfect crime. So what can we do about it? Well, the good news is we can save the forests. But to do that, we have to change the way we think about them and not regard them just as a source of timber that we can liquidate for easy cash, but as an essential part of the biosphere we depend on. The economics must change fundamentally. Mounting evidence shows that involving people who live in the forest in decision-making about what happens to the forest is critical to keeping those forests alive. Brazil, for example, has taken steps to recognize customary land rights and indigenous people's claims to forest land. 37% of Brazil's forests are now under indigenous management. This NASA photograph shows land belonging to the Kayapo people, the large block of green in the top of the photograph, ringed by the fires used to destroy the surrounding forest. So whereas Brazil hasn't solved its deforestation problem by any stretch, these are big steps in the right direction. Liberia, meanwhile, is at a crossroads. The illegal logging scandals of the last couple of years have forced the government to review its approach. And this has opened a small window of opportunity to seize power from the vested interests and give it to the community so they can manage their own land for their own benefit. This opportunity must be seized. And schemes like this give them the support they need to succeed in Liberia and elsewhere. And there's been plenty of talk at the UN climate change meetings about rich countries paying poor countries to keep their forests standing. Plenty of talk, but little action. Money must be made available, and it will be expensive, around £30 billion a year, in fact, but that is 63 times less than the world pays in subsidies for fossil fuels right now per year. So, forests need money, and the only other thing we need to save the forests is a little common sense. The obvious thing is to end the impunity I've discussed. If it's illegal, prosecute. Fine or jail the perpetrators. Confiscate their assets. Seize contraband goods. Treat them like we do other criminals. There are laws to this effect in place in the EU and the US. These laws need to be extended and made to bite. Secondly, we, as taxpayers, can stop funding the logging industry in the first place. Much of this industry depends on hidden subsidies. And international aid donors pump these in with our tax money into some of the most corrupt institutions in very corrupt countries. We need to tell our governments we don't want to finance our own destruction and they should be investing instead in alternative approaches. And we need our financial institutions to stop bankrolling companies that destroy forests for a living. In 2012, we launched a campaign to expose what HSBC was doing in Sarawak. Our spoof film, starring British comedian and environmentalist Bill Oddie, went viral and helped force the bank to review its forest policy. We customers have power. Banks should not be financing the destruction of the world's forests, and if enough of us tell them so, they'll begin to listen. And we need the conservation organizations like WWF to do their job. They exist to save the planet, and they won't do it unless they condemn industrial logging straight out and work to develop alternatives. Because without their endorsement and practical involvement, companies and governments cannot sell industrial logging in the tropics as a benign and sustainable activity. And this will affect us all, too. Soaring wasteful consumption in the rich world is driving demand for what this industry does overseas. We must reroute the money that is bankrolling the perfect crime into saving the world's forests. We owe it to the billion people who live in them. We owe it to our children. We need to wake up and act, or we will all, loggers included, be victims of the perfect crime. Thank you.